In the previous video, we saw the need to split the amplitude axis into discrete levels. Analog values nearby are quantized or latched into these discrete levels so that we get a finite set of measurable values. The number of levels that we can use to represent different amplitude depends fundamentally on how data is represented and stored in the digital format. And fundamentally, the smallest unit of data in electronics is a switch or a binary bit, where data or the state value can be represented as either on or off, high or low, two possible values, a binary system. We can expand this binary system to include a cascade of switches or bits. Though a single bit can only represent two distinct values, a number of bits together can quickly escalate the number of distinct state representations possible. Two bits can represent four unique states. Three bits can represent eight. Four bits can represent 16, and so on. You can see a pattern here. The growth is exponential. More precisely, the growth in the number of unique states possible is a power of 2. Here, n is the number of bits used. You can see that things grow pretty fast in an exponential setting. 16 bits can represent 65,500 different values. 24 bits can represent 16.7 million values. And 32 bits can represent a whopping 4.2 billion state values. That's the power of combinations and permutations for you. I'm not going to delve too deep into binary representation or binary arithmetic here. There are several resources out there, and I can link a few in the description. But I'm going to try and draw some parallels between the binary number system, or the base 2 number system, and the system that we're most accustomed to, the decimal number system, or the base 10 number system. Let's take an example of 8 bits. 8 bits can accommodate 2 to the power of 8 different unique states. That's 256 different values, from the 0th state, when all the bits are low, to the 255th state, when all the bits are high. The binary system is base 2, since each digit is capable of representing 2 states, either 0 or 1. And likewise, the decimal system is base 10, as each digit has a range between 0 and 9. Numbers in both systems are written from left to right, with the most significant digit on the left side and the least significant digit on the right. It's called so because modifying the least significant digit has the least impact to the overall number that it represents. And on the other hand, changing the most significant digit will significantly alter the number. Although a bit may be the smallest unit of data, it's too small and limited to be individually operated upon. Digital systems and computers would rather prefer a group of bits together and perform operations on the group. The smallest such group is called a byte, and a byte is just a group of 8 bits. Thus, a byte is the smallest addressable unit of memory in computer architectures. That's one of the reasons why you find bit rates, or bit depths in this case, always as a multiple of 8, you know, like 16 bits, 24, 32, and so on. Having said that, let's just use 4 bits to represent our amplitude values. I'm doing this so we can simplify the process of illustration and understand the concepts better by just having 16 distinct values. Note that a 4-bit representation, or a bit depth of 4, is never used in audio. Not only is the resolution super low and wildly inaccurate, it's also wasteful, since you're not using 4 of the 8 available bits. As I already mentioned, a byte is the smallest unit of memory a computer operates upon. Even if you use only 4 bits for storing a value, the container that it's held in always contains 8 bits. 4 other bits are just set to 0 all the time. We'll look at a snapshot of audio which is centered around the baseline. Let's play it and listen to it for a while. A part of you and I collide. You're meant to ignore all that you know. what you listened to was produced at a sample rate of 44.1 kHz and at a bit depth of 16. This is your average CD quality music. You can't really notice anything wrong with it. Audacity also translates the samples in this audio file into 32 bits. This doesn't mean that we're magically increasing the resolution of the audio file from 16 bits to 32 bits. All it means is that Audacity likes to work with 32 bits of data, as a 32-bit floating point number is a common data format in programming languages. And it also gives you the advantage of extra headroom within the digital domain. But for all intents and purposes, we'll consider this audio file, what we just heard, as having 16 bits of resolution and the absolute best version that we have. Now, let's have some fun by destroying it. So what we want to do is reduce the bit depth and hear the difference. Let's do something drastic. Let's reduce the bit depth to 4 bits. With 4 bits, you get 16 amplitude levels, which is piss poor resolution to say the least. We need to forcefully reduce the resolution and we leverage the Nyquist prompt for it. I'm going to select the track, go to Tools, Nyquist prompt, and I'm going to enter this command. We're going to quantize the entire track such that it has 16 levels. 8 on and above the baseline, and 8 more below the baseline. Hit enter, and we can see that the track just came out of a Minecraft filter. And if we zoom in, we can clearly see 16 distinct amplitude levels that the samples can take. No single sample in this entire track lies in between these 16 amplitude levels. Let's hear it. A part of you and I collide. You're meant to ignore all that you know. That sounds horrendous. How would you describe the sound? Noisy would be a good description. You can hear the music, you could probably even recognize it from the original, except that it has a lot of unwanted noise. Here's the original, and here's the low resolution render. Let's try to extract just the noise element. We can technically do this by subtracting one track from the other. Over here in Audacity, there's no subtract option. But what you could do is invert the phase of one of the tracks and add the two together. It's essentially a subtraction operation. Let's try that. I'll select one of the tracks, go to Effects, Invert. Now I'll select both the tracks, head over to Tracks, Mix, and Mix and Render to New Track. Let's hear it. There are two really interesting facts that we can deduce from this track. One, the noise is a function of the audio. What does that mean? It isn't white noise or randomly generated noise. White noise sounds like this. This noise, on the other hand, moves and sways along with the song. You can hear this more evidently in the quieter sections of the song. The noise is determined by the underlying audio. The second point to note, strangely enough, is that the noise amplitude is constant. Look at the meters here. The meters read around negative 24 decibels full scale. If you want to learn more about the decibel scale and how audio levels are measured, check out the module on loudness and level. Looking at the level meter here, no matter where I navigate to in the track, the levels read the same. The noise track's waveform itself is squiggly and doesn't suggest any uniformity, and yet the levels are constant. The original track has a decent amount of dynamic range, but the noise associated with a bit depth of 4 is constant. Now let's give this experiment another shot. But this time, we'll use a bit depth of 8 instead of 4. With a bit depth of 8, you're allowed a decent range of amplitude values. 256 to be precise. This is nowhere close to 65,500 possible amplitude values with a 16-bit resolution, but it's fairly better than the measly 16 possible values that we got earlier. Here, we have the original track again, and I'm gonna forcefully quantize the track to 8 bits. A part of you and I collide. You're meant to ignore all that you know. As you listen to the track, depending on how and where you're listening to, you may or may not hear the noise. I say this because there's definitely noise present in the track, but it's low enough that it may not be heard if you're listening to it in a noisy environment or if you're listening to it at low volume. You can hear the noise better in quieter sections of the track. To wake and to kiss amidst all the folks in the sky. Let's isolate the noise like we did before. We can observe a similar trend with the noise signal here, that it's constant power. But the level meter indicates that the noise levels are much lower than before, at around negative 48 dB full scale. Based on these observations, we can postulate that quantization can add a degree of error into the signal. And this error is heard as broadband noise. So in simpler terms, as you reduce the resolution of the signal by decreasing the bit depth, you add more error into the signal, which results in more noise. Does that mean that a 16-bit track has some noise in it as well? Absolutely. But the noise levels are so low that for most intents and purposes, it can be considered noise-free. But we can theoretically calculate the noise levels we can expect for any bit depth. Signal to quantization noise ratio, or SQNR, is a widely used metric in measuring the quality of the analog to digital conversion process. Though it's not the only metric used, it gives us an idea about the dynamic range that's possible with a given bit depth. It's a simple formula, where Q is the bit depth. You can see that the only factor that determines the signal-to-noise ratio is the bit depth. So this formula can be further simplified like this. So if I substitute the value of bit depth to 4, we get the signal-to-quantization noise ratio of about 24 decibels. This is practically what we saw with the constant noise floor at the negative 24 dB earlier. This technically means that for an audio track quantized at 4 bits, we have a maximum dynamic range of 24 decibels. With a bit depth of 8, we get the signal to quantization noise ratio as 48 decibels. Again, exactly what we noticed in the level meters for 8-bit quantization earlier. Now, for 16 bits, we get the SQNR as 96 decibels. Now, what does this mean in practice? It means that if you're in the quietest setting possible, you'll have to drive a 16-bit audio track up to 96 decibels of loudness, which is quite high, to even begin to hear the noise associated with quantization. I am not saying that 16 bits of resolution is enough or adequate. It all depends on the usage and application. The human ear is capable of perceiving sounds from the threshold of hearing at 0 decibels to the threshold of pain at around 130 decibels of sound pressure. This means that we humans have a theoretical dynamic range of 130 decibels that we can fully tap into and experience in an ideal setting. If we are seated in a soundproofed anechoic chamber, and an audio track produced at 16 bits of resolution is played back at a deafening 110 decibels, during the quietest parts of this audio track or during silence, you could easily hear the quantization noise, as it would be around 14 decibels loud. But if you're in your living room, listening to music at comfortable levels, The noise floor of the signal will be well below the threshold of hearing, and the noise will never be heard. What about 24 bits then? We can see that the signal to quantization noise ratio for 24 bits of audio is around 144 decibels. That's a bigger dynamic range than we can even perceive. You can be fairly confident that with a 24-bit depth audio track, no matter what the listening environment is, no matter what the application is, you'd never be able to hear the quantization noise. This begs the question, though. Why not just use 24 bits as standard? Well, for one, going from 16 bits to 24 bits will increase the size of the audio file by 50%. As engineers, we need to strive to utilize resources as best as possible. Now, the interesting thing is, bit depth isn't the end-all, be-all factor which determines the noise that is heard. I choose my words carefully here because I'm not saying that the amount of noise or the noise power would differ for the same bit depth. In fact, no matter what you do, at 16 bits of resolution, you'll always have a constant noise power, which is represented as negative 96 decibels of full-scale amplitude. But the type of noise you can hear can be changed. I'll show you what I mean. This here is white noise, randomly generated broadband noise. Since it's randomly generated, the frequency distribution is quite uniform across the board, meaning that all the frequencies have equal weightage. Pay attention to the signal level as well. Now listen to this noise. Take a look at the level meters. It says that the level of this noise is similar to that of the white noise, but it feels so much quieter. Why is that? If you look at the frequency response of this noise, we observe that the lower frequencies are boosted up and the higher ones are reduced. It's the same noise power as earlier, but we've shuffled that power around and changed the balance of it. Regarding why this sounds quieter, is all to do with our ears and how we perceive loudness for different frequencies. It's covered in quite a lot of depth in the module on loudness and levels, and I'll be glossing over it in the next video as well. But what if we could apply this concept and shift the balance of power of the quantization noise? Could that reduce the loudness of the noise from the error signal? Going further, what if we could move this noise out of the audible spectrum entirely into the inaudible spectrum? All of this is well within the realm of possibility, and in fact is being done in several commercial digital systems without the end user ever knowing about it. It's the science of dithering and noise shaping, and it's coming up next. Until then, make some noise.